First of all, let me thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to talk to you about something which is quite an exciting topic, which I have learned myself over the years, starting from early days of master's course which I have done and carried through till now, and even today I am a student learning the art of scientific presentation. And I feel that there is lot much one can learn, first by listening to people and trying to have an attitude that today or tomorrow you are going to become a good speaker who can sell the products. I don't intend to say that you are going to become a sales representative sometime down the line, but the product that you have, it may be some wonderful results. But if you present it poorly, it will not get the deserving attention. So one should really know how to sell the product. There are several things that one can learn, and I've learned over the years how to sell my product. That is, of course, the research output that comes from my laboratory. So I will summarize my thoughts on this. These are guidelines, not necessarily rules. The talk is entitled Secrets of Real Life Learning Process in Scientific Presentation. Start with a lighthearted disclaimer. I'm going to do a little bit of acting on stage. So if the acting coincides with any of your actions, please take it as deliberate. And I can only say sorry towards the end of it if you find some similarity. First of all, I don't know any one of you. That's a good thing, that you will not blame me that you deliberately try to enact me. So that's not my intention. The outline of the talk is, the first I will talk about content creation, that how will you prepare for a seminar, what content you want to put in into the slides, and why you want to put in those contents. So that will be the focus of the first module. Then I will talk about preparation and practice, how well you have to prepare and how well you have to practice. Delivery on stage tips. On stage there are so many things that people are quite nervous about, on stage performance. It's a performing arts, okay. It in one sense it is something that you have to go to the stage and perform yourself, and there is no other outlet, there is no other way out. You have to be on stage and performing, and how do you tackle that? And improvement, which is a very continuous process, that also I will touch upon. So this is the outline of the talk. And many times, let me also tell you that many times I have seen in student presentations that all of them will have a title slide, and then comes a slide which is like, again, which in one sense it looks pretty much similar to what I have on that is outline. Most of them have. But at end of it, funny part is that I always feel like laughing that the fifth one would be conclusion. For God's sake, any talk will have a conclusion. You don't have to necessarily state it once again. And also many people will have an introduction on top of all this. And in introduction, conclusion are sort of redundant. It's implied. It's going to be anyway there. So you don't put that as the outline. It is not really part of the outline, but it is ingredient. It is an integral part of any scientific talk. So don't put that in the outline. Content creation, it starts first with attitude. A scientific talk, a well-prepared talk, is made several days ago, not in the preceding night of your MTech presentation. It is never made in the preceding night, because the very problem is that the attitude is incorrect, because you are taking that as a mandatory requirement as part of your course, or mandatory requirement as part of something else that you are part of. Fundamentally, your approach is that you are taking it as a burden instead of finding it as an enjoyable task, because this is something that is going to be getting paid off in the long run. If you present well, you are going to be well received in very many different platforms, be it as a sales representative, be it as a company executive, as a group leader, as a scientist, as a teacher. Any forum you go, there is no runaway from not presenting well. So it's very, very fundamental that you have the right attitude. What is attitude? The secret of joy in work is contained in one word, that is excellence. You have to thrive to be excellent, okay? And where you start is immaterial. History is immaterial. What was your past is immaterial. But it's about the attitude that, yes, I want to become a good presenter in future or in the days to come or in next 4 years. By the time I finish this program, I want to be a good presenter, a confident presenter on stage. This attitude is the starting point. Okay? So to know how to do something well is to enjoy it. So as I said before, that there is no run away from this huge responsibility on your shoulder, that you have to begin to learn and to enjoy what you are doing. Okay. So it is certainly not a burden, it's a pleasurable exercise. As you become more and more comfortable on stage, talking about your own results, talking about literature, you're going to be doing pretty much fine on stage. So this is the starting point, attitude, develop the right attitude. Okay. So this is a, again, lighthearted comment. A teacher gives a book to a student, if you could read. You know, in this generation, everyone is very fancy about SMS messages. Teacher tells that, just think of this book as if you are reading a long text message. So it's just a small inversion of the attitude. The student thinks that, oh, big book, oh, I have to read all these pages. No, I'm not for it. So it's a negative attitude towards the book. But the teacher tells that to develop the right attitude, you think that it's a long text. So the student has, oh, okay, is it a long text? Okay, let me try. So the attitude, the correct at your end, that yes, I want to do a good job, not in immediate future, but in the long run. When I say long run, if you are enrolled in a program, say 4 years is a good enough period for you to come from zero all the way up to say 90 plus in a scale of 100, okay, in terms of rating of how good you present. Now the content creation, which is most important, and remove all the wrong notions that if my slides are graphically the best, I have a great presentation made, which is the incorrect notion. So content is the most important point. Okay. Once you have the attitude that, yes, I want to do a good presentation, the content creation is the starting point. Understand the topic very well. Here, there is a lot of effort that is required. It calls in the knowledge that you have, the confidence that you have on the subject, and how well you have understood. If you have not understood something clearly, talk to your colleagues, talk to your supervisor, talk to your lab mates in somehow, or read additional books, resort to internet resources, all modes of learning, you make sure that you are done with it such that you feel confident about the content. That forms the basis of confidence. Poorer the content, lower would be the confidence. Okay. That is the very origin of people going to the stage and sweating. Okay, they will like take the hanky and do all kinds of things, sweating. There are very many things that has its origin in the content of the slide, and you only know that, oh, that between 10th and 15th slide, I have something which I never understood. You might have gone through such situations like, oh, I don't think I know it, but then why the hell that slide is there? Okay, don't take the risk of having something in it which you don't have any control over. Okay. Keep that in mind, that you put slides which you understand better, and then you should also think about, while preparing the slides, preparing the content, you should also think about what are the points to be included, what are the points to be stressed, and what are the points to be flashed. What do I mean by flashed? Okay. There are slides which are only of supporting value, not necessarily the main focus. But the supporting slides would help you, but don't spend too much time on the supporting slide. So that comes under the category of slides to be flashed. Now, next aspect is know your audience. Okay. As far as I am concerned, I can only read the non-verbal communication part. I can read the body language, read the faces, but I have no idea about who you are. Fortunately, I am not giving a scientific presentation. I am only talking about ways to give a scientific presentation. There is a huge difference between that. If I am to give a talk in chemistry, the department I come from, I really need to know your background. Maybe you're a master's student or research scholars, or your teachers from different colleges, or your scientists from different national laboratories. I need to know to whom I'm speaking to. This is very important. Even if you go and speak to school children in high school, never ever underestimate the audience. That is very, very fundamental to a successful scientific talk. Never underestimate the audience. There may be audience who are disinterested, not paying any attention to what you are doing, but that's a different aspect, but never underestimate them. don't think that you are master of the topic that you have in hand. Yes, it adds value to the confidence, but not necessarily that you should look down upon the audience and think that, oh, I know better than anyone in the audience. You will be really sacked by certain questions, targeted questions, and there are people in the audience who know how to throw stones bullseye. Dart, spot on. The biggest limitation in your presentation they will capture. So never underestimate the audience, give some respect to the audience and talk to them as if you want to exchange ideas with them. Okay, respect the audience, that is very important. Now, with regards to preparation of slide, order of slide is very important. Which slide should come first? Which should follow that? Which should come five slides in progress of your talk? What should be the 10th slide? What should be the 15th slide? So, what I can tell you is that a story that is written in your mind is the story that should come in the slide. So, it is the mental exercise first at your end. Jot down the points, make, you know, scratchy little notes in your booklet before you go on to make the slide. Without no idea about the flow, if you directly sit in front of a PowerPoint presentation and start making the slide, it's not going to work. Because fundamentally where one would go wrong is in the flow, which is very, very important. The flow is as important as if you tell a story, people would appreciate that. If you don't tell a story, they will make a story on you. That how hopeless the talk was. And you will hear during the tea time, oh, that guy, hopeless. At the same time, if you give a good talk, someone would come and pat your shoulder, hey, great talk here, great talk, well done. And someone would, you will even overhear someone say that, awesome talk. So it feels good, you know, you feel good. So make sure that you have a good flow. Let me illustrate. Famous lines from Lord Tennyson. I have highlighted a few of these in a different color just to illustrate the concept of flow and how important the flow is. It's a beautiful poem and I'm going to narrate and explain. Just to highlight that I come from haunts of coot and hern to bicker down a valley, 30 hills I hurry down, half a hundred bridges. Let me stop there. So it's about a brook, how big the ocean before it merges with the ocean, the origin of all these rivers will have at some mountain, some hilltop, where the origin is important. Where it is, I come from the haunts of coot and hern. Coot is a kind of bird. So it come from somewhere. And then bicker down the valley, so it is like slowly flowing down the valley. So you are taking a journey, right? You have an origin, taking a journey, and then hurry, 30 hills hurry down. So it talks about how downgrade the river is flowing, coming to half a hundred bridges. It has crossed over half a hundred bridges. So it speaks for the flow of events, and that makes the poem beautiful. Okay, and then till last by Philip's farm is not so important, till last I flow to join the brimming river. So it's a major, major, major event that a small little brook merges with a major river. So all these attributes you will see in your scientific presentation. You start from the introduction, from the haunts of coot and hern, you start from the introduction, slowly define what you are going to speak, why that topic is important. And you can see the flow, and this flow is extremely important. And when you find the flow, yes, there is a flow, I think it's a good talk. That feel is good. That feel is important. That is why I say that if you make a good presentation, content for a good presentation, you feel good. Why you feel good? Because you see the flow. You see the connection. And at last, for men may come and men may go, but I go on forever. That means if you develop that skill, if you develop the skill of giving a presentation, it will remain forever with you. That's my interpretation of this same poem in the context of today's talk. Now, decide on the sequence of slides. How do you decide on the sequence? That the content, the connection, the flow, you have thought about that and you put together say 15 or 20 different slides. And when you want to get full mastery, full control over the sequence of slide, you must know what was slide number 2, what was slide number 7. And from 7, you may have to go back to slide number 2 for whatever reasons. just to address probably a question from the audience or to illustrate some additional points. So you must know content of every slide and what sequence it appears. That gives, that acts as a tremendous confidence booster that you are entirely in control of what you are doing on stage. Okay. Now, in introduction, describe the background of the work and give due credit to other people who have done the work before, because nothing can come from heaven, as scientists would say, nothing comes from heaven, but you have to describe what is the background, where did it all originate from, and give credits to people who have done the work, done the similar work before. And if you become very well experienced, you could always do the following, that when you talk about, say, Professor Kannan's work, and you have a slide which cites one of his papers or one of his contributions, and I would say Professor Kannan from IIT Bombay had recently shown that, and it gives a sense of attachment with the community. It's not like, oh, some Kannan, that's different. If you are a scientist and if you are giving a technical talk, always, you know, have some sort of attachment and affiliation and the location. It gives a feel that, okay, at least I have seen Professor Kannan on the website and I know that he is in IIT Bombay. And that's a part of the culture that when we gather in a say in a marriage reception, for example, and we introduce people to each other, right? Oh, he stays there. It's a part of culture. And in science, the part of culture, science and technology, the part of culture is that you should talk about the affiliation. Professor Kannan from IIT Bombay had recently shown. It gives a different feel as compared to you telling that, oh, some Kannan had shown recently. These two are different things. Okay. So keep in mind, if you are more and more confident, also talk about the affiliation. And good to have supporting slides after a blank slide at the end of your presentation, because supporting slides can act as a rescue slide in case you are bombarded with questions, which typically happens in MTech and PhD presentations. And about the way the slides are prepared, don't go for too fancy slides. Keep in mind there are only two colors which are really good, black and blue, because I use it. Because there is a scientific justification, these two colors are visible from far behind. And you never know what kind of room your seminar is going to take place. I had no idea how this room would look like when I came. But keep a font size of minimum 24 if you are using PowerPoint. And this same font size is visible even if I give the same talk in PCSA or in a much larger classroom of, say, 500 students sitting. And even the backbencher, the VIPs who sit in the backbench, even for them it is visible. So keep that in mind. And color selection is important. Do not use light colors. And there is something which is written light here, L-I-G-H-T, and I don't know how many of those letters are visible. And many people use that in scientific presentations. Do not use fancy colors thinking that, oh, that will glorify my slide and that will, you know, enhance the appearance of my slide. These are wrong notions. And when it comes to language, what language I should use? Should I use a long sentence? No. You should try to learn how to use telegraphic language. Just pointer-based languages, because you are presenting to an audience. We don't have enough time to go and read all the sentences that you make. So keep a language which is simple and telegraphic, and make sure that there are no mistakes in whatever little you have written. Now, with regards to the text, so many times famous speakers, Nobel laureates on stage, they will have a long passage in the single slide, text-rich slides. It's a distraction. It's a distraction for the audience. Do you know there is a interesting graph, like Professor Gaitonde talked about graphs. There is an interesting graph, time on the x-axis and concentration, attention on the y-axis. After 7 minutes of any scientific presentation, the concentration exponentially decreases. This is a fact, it's a proven fact. So concentration level of the audience will exponentially decrease. Okay, so you have to really work hard to bring back the concentration, bring the audience back to you and your presentation. It's an effort. First, you recognize and realize that the concentration is not going to last like a DC current throughout. It's going to drop down dramatically. So if you use text-rich slides, that's the best way, the best starting point for the audience to go to sleep. Aram se, they will just go back to sleep, nice AC room, yeah, this is the right time to sleep, okay. So never put slides which are too much textual with lot of statements on it, and leave some empty space if possible. In case you, if you cannot avoid using large content, suppose you are giving a talk on literature, on how to appreciate literature. Okay, I have one passage from one of my favorite authors. I will go back and come back to this slide once again. Oh, high on text. Will anyone, do you think anyone, how many, what percentage of audience will even bother to look at, so much of text? No, it's not for me. That would be the immediate reaction from the audience. Okay, however, the same content you can use animation effectively. The same thing. As matters stand today, many teachers are unable to do best of which they are capable. For this, there are a number of reasons, some more or less accidental, others deep-seated. To begin with, the former, most teachers are overworked and compelled to prepare their pupils for examinations rather than to give them liberalizing mental training. So, emphasis there, liberalizing mental training. So, in the context of a full page text, I am picking that word. One of the major responsibilities of a teacher is to impart liberalizing mental training. Okay, it's a very important point. And then goes on to the same paragraph in a fashion which comes as a module, okay, comes in the form of module. People who are not accustomed to teaching, these are sort of revolutionary statements. And it had sent its own ripples in, you know, late 40s and early 50s in United Kingdom. The people who are not accustomed to teaching, and this includes practically all education authorities, very powerful statement, have no idea of the expense of spirit that it involves. It's all about teaching, okay. And then this is even more something with the statement which I liked really best. Clergymen are not expected to preach sermons for several hours a day, but analogous effort is demanded of teachers. If you look at the college teachers, they teach how many hours a day? So these are thought provoking statements which Bertrand Russell had done in his unpopular essays late 1940s. It's so characteristic of today's affairs. He is a visionary, he is a mathematician, philosopher and a writer. He is a visionary, he made the statement several years ago, how true it is. The result is that many of them become harassed and nervous, out of touch with recent work in the subject that they teach, and unable to inspire their students with a sense of intellectual delights to be obtained from new understanding and new knowledge. How appropriate is this statement in today's context? Okay. So, going back, what I have done, a text-rich paragraph, I split using mode of simple animation, emphasized on certain aspect of it, and try to convey the meaning. Okay, if you ever happen to deal with a text-rich slide, make sure that you use animation effectively and stress the point, modulate, demodulate as you do it. Now, with regards to tables and data, avoid data-intensive table. Okay, how do I avoid data-intensive table? I have one to show. So, this table has too many entries in it, and you are not expected to understand the scientific content of it, but just as an illustration, this table has too many numbers. But then the question from the audience point of view is that, oh, which one I should look at? So there is no clue as far as audience is concerned, which one I should look at. So you could use some kind of highlighting, some kind of animation or some kind of additional color to emphasize what is the most important finding in this table. So when you deal with a data intensive slide, make sure that you give special emphasis, special attention to certain regions in the table. But don't expect the audience to follow every entry that you have made in the table. Okay? So that is important. So here, these are the important one. I use this number 31.6 and this 37.5 to derive something that is written in this box down here, anti-addition is more favored. So these two numbers are good enough to point out that very, very essential finding, a finding which I could obtain in my group after a struggle of 2 long years. Each entry takes about 6 months in this table. Therefore, you should also show that, look, I have so much of data and it's very painful to get them. But I don't want you to burden with all those data, but keep in mind these two entries, this 31 and 37, will give me this very precious conclusion. So on one hand, you have shown that you have wonderful set of data. On the other hand, you have also highlighted what is most important point in this data. Okay. So that is a way to handle data intensive slide, which comes very handy when you deal with variety of scientific and engineering problems. Now, preparing slides, uniformity and appearance. This is something, an illustration that I am sipping water middle of my presentation. This is illustration. Sipping water middle of my presentation, if at all ever your mouth get dry, mouth gets dry, take a sip of water. Nobody is going to think or feel bad about that. You know, you are on stage, you must be in full control of what is going on. It's not their job who is sitting on the other side. So if you feel dry, take a sip of water. That is again an illustration. Uniformity and appearance of graphics, it's very important. You could have a theme. What is a theme? A theme is what I have, that I have a heading for most of my slides, and I have a red line that is there, you know, separating the heading from rest of the content. And I also have some RB Sunoj at the corner, if that is visible, in a very faint font color deliberately. And there is a theme, and if you look at Microsoft, it offers a lot of fancy themes, like, you know, very fancy themes. I am not encouraging the use of very graphically embellished theme, but you could have a theme of your own, keep it simple, and use uniform font colors, and graphics also should be having some sort of theme which gives a better feel for your talk. And with regards to decoration and animation, okay, there is a wrong notion among students that if you decorate it so fancy with like 7 WebGIOR colors, and friends will say that, oh, awesome slide, yeah, great slide. So don't get carried away by that. What is important is the content. As I said, you could always try to improve the slide and its graphics quality, animation, etc. when you are done with the contents. Do not waste your time to begin with working on the graphical treat. So this you keep it at the end when you have sufficient time after creating the content, you can go on to decorate these slides. Uniformity in appearance, again an important aspect. Figures should be of good quality, Professor Gaitonde mentioned about, readable from distance. This is an important point. I said that you never know, the same presentation you may make to a smaller group of audience in a small room and maybe a big auditorium with, you know, 500 people, 1000 people sitting and listening to you. So when you make the slide, it cannot be auditorium dependent unless you have a prior knowledge about that. When you make it, make sure that it is a multipurpose slide. Therefore, keep a font size, keep good quality graphics which is visible from distance, and you could include slide numbers. And now, so we have gone through, what we have gone through is to have a right attitude, think about the slide, order of the slide, and then create the slide, use some general recommendations. Now that, so there is a pause, now that you have the slides, what next? And again, I am going to illustrate, why did I take a pause and say, now that you have the slides, what next? So there has been a flow in what I was doing, and suddenly I took a small little break and re-emphasized, okay, I have the slides now. So there is a modulation. Like I started realizing that some in the audience are beginning to doze down and sleeping, or some had already lost attention, and then I am bringing back the audience, okay, I have the slides, what next? So suddenly my voice went up. This is called modulation. It is very important for giving a successful talk. You can't be monotonously saying that a clergyman was never asked to, you could do all kinds of things. Make sure that you learn how to modulate. And when to modulate? It's not like in every sentence one would use some high pitch and say that. That's not really modulation. It is annoying modulation. You modulate when there is a digression, when there is change of color, when there is a change of season. Okay, when if the change of season from winter to spring, we could sense it, you know, birds chirp and you know new buds will come out. So all this is a change, and when there is going to be a change, like the way I said, okay, we have the slides ready, what next? So that is change of season, the digression, a new topic. So there you try to bring back the audience and bring back their attention. There you have to modulate, and you must modulate. Otherwise, no one would recognize that, oh, one topic has gone and you are moving on to the next topic. So I am bringing back the theme once again. So those are in the light color, deliberately not there, but I could see on my screen the content creation, what we have done till now. Then I am talking about preparation and practice. That is the second step, preparation and practice. I did look at my watch to see where I am in terms of time. Preparation and practice. Oh, okay. A tall, big guy, no fear. And a small guy, no fear. Pronounced same. Means very, very different. Is there a connection with what I am talking? So, my interpretation is that you know your fear, and that will lead you to a situation where you don't have fear. So, slides back once again. Know your fear, then you will have no fear. Okay? So, this is the thing. Fight or flight. Either fight it on stage, do a good job, or quit. Run away. No. I can't give a presentation. I am very nervous. But question is, how long you can go in that mode, how long you can shy away from giving a presentation. It is an attribute that every modern day kid should have. World has become global. Americans with much inferior, I hope this goes world wide web, this statement. Americans with much inferior caliber, they are trained in their schools how to sell their products. And the guy would come with tie and say that, oh, my product is best in the world, and with all the American accent attached. My product is best in the world, and poor people on the other side will think that, oh, his product is best. That's because they know how to sell their product. Okay. So let us address this problem on stage issues, on stage preparation and practice. If you know what are these root source of fear, you will have no fear at the end. Okay. Now, don't be casual, too casual on stage. Be little bit serious. I have seen our IIT kids come with a slipper and a Bermuda and a casual t-shirt, and as teachers we have always paid little serious attention and said that next time when you present, come in formal dress. Okay, so next time they will all be formal. So make sure that you don't be too casual. For beginners, practice a lot. First time presentation, nervous. Hands are like very cold and sweating, and you know, you are feeling very cold, air conditioned room, no, it is, I think it is minus 20 kind of, you are feeling very cold because you are nervous. Okay, that is where you have to know fear, know your fear. What is the source of it? What is the source of it? And the practice will help a lot. For beginners, first time presenters, go to a room, close the door, practice in front of mirror. If you are feeling nervous, this does not apply to all. Many people are not nervous about giving a presentation, so this recommendation is not for them. But if you ever feel nervous, it's a good idea to go in front of the mirror. And usually, in like I believe that most homes will have the full tall mirror, and you can present in front of that first. Then practice with your eyes closed and dream about your presentation. It's very, very important. I've been hugely successful in doing that. And many of the content in this slide are based on my real life experience. You can dream about what you are talking, what you are going to speak tomorrow, what you are going to speak day after tomorrow. You can dream about that. How do you dream? By knowing every slide and the content and the connection, and you will close your eyes and think, okay, this is the first slide, I will talk about this, I will stress about that. And do not try to by heart the statements that you are going to make on stage. It doesn't work that way. And it can be even dangerous. If you forget two sentences, then you like begin to scratch and look up the skies for somebody's mercy. All these on stage non-verbal communication, which I will touch upon shortly. Practice different layers of practice by yourself, and practice in your dreams, daydreams, and give a mock presentation to a friendly group of audience to begin with. When I say friendly group, your best friends who will never criticize you, because if they criticize you, they are no longer your friends. That's sort of the way we have grown up, right? So take 3-4 of best friends and say that, you listen to me, tell me the positive constructive suggestions, okay? I have my research group meetings, people are really butchered, broken into pieces. But end of it, they all grow better and they all become good presenters of tomorrow, okay? So mock presentation is important if you get time, and this is where the presentation has to start way ahead of time so that you can also afford to give a mock presentation before your real presentation. Time management, it's very important. I keep looking at the watch. It is very important, and it has a huge connection with the way you speak. There is no universal rule that 1 minute per slide, 2 minutes per slide, 5 minutes per slide. It depends on what is your natural speed. Okay, depending on natural speed, you decide how many slides you can afford for a 20 minutes presentation. So it is a personal attribute, not dictated by your advisor. Okay, I have lots of remarks to make about advices. As I go along, I will keep touching upon that. Time management is a decision done by you, okay? And you only know how fast you can speak, how slow you can speak. Avoid elaborate introduction. This is again part of the time management, and lot of our fancy M.Tech students, what they do, first stage presentation, they will have 20 slides, 18 of them introduction. Oh, topic is very well introduced, and then results and discussion one slide and conclusion last slide. So people are smart. Do they think that they are smart? Then faculty would rip them off by saying that you come back again, you repeat the course, okay? So don't put too much of introduction, because it gives a very wrong sense of what you are trying to do. When you do a serious presentation, make sure that only a fraction of your total time is dedicated for introductory slides. Okay, that is important, how to manage between different sections. Now, moving on to the on-stage tips, very, very important, delivery of the content. So what I have done till now, content creation, preparation and practice, so you have done everything, okay? You have good content, you are feeling confident, you know every slide of it, you know everything that is there in the slide, you have prepared well enough. What next? Delivery on stage. Yes, you are on stage. It's time to perform. And to me, it is an opportunity. To me, it is not about being nervous on stage, because then you are messing up the show. You are a performer on stage, and the stage belongs to you, and make good use of that. And as I said, I wanted to be introduced. I walked into the stage slowly and steadily. Never rush to the stage. If you rush to the stage, what will happen? You will be like sighing deep, and you will completely lose control of the first few minutes. Of course, everybody would overcome after first few minutes. In first few minutes, what happens is that there is a natural increase in the adrenaline level in your blood. Adrenaline is pumped seriously into your bloodstream such that you are equipped do the task. So you're on duty, on stage, you're supposed to perform a task at your hand, then you need some extra energy, extra vital, you know, supplies, increased oxygen level through your bloodstream, more energy to be spent on stage, okay. If that is the case, adrenaline level will naturally go up. When adrenaline level goes up, your heartbeat will increase, and if you interpret that this is because of nervousness, you're wrong. Yes, nervousness has a contribution, but you realize that is where I say that know your fear. Adrenaline level will increase, therefore your heartbeat will increase and your hands will become colder than before. These are all natural, okay? It is not that only it happens to you, it happens to everybody. And they all know how to manage, you are learning how to manage. So you have to approach, and this is intricately tied with the attitude aspect which I was mentioning before. You know your fear. On stage, first few minutes, yes, you have increased heartbeat, but don't pay attention to the heartbeat. You have a task at hand to perform. It's not that you're, oh, I'm nervous. What can I do? I will tell you some small little techniques. When you come to the stage, you must have a smiling face. You should be smiling. Those who know me, when they see me smile, they will all laugh. So since you people don't know me, how comic I can get, you're not laughing. So when you come to the stage, keep a smiling face. Look at the audience. Look at the audience and don't present a very serious face on stage, because then everybody gets serious. It's not all about being very serious on stage. Then the fun part is gone. You may not be really enjoying what you're doing on stage. Keep a smiling face. Spend about first 30 seconds. Do nothing. It's a very important tip on stage. First 30 seconds, just do nothing. What you should do, look at the mic as if you have invented it. And then look at the pointer. Usually they will give a pointer and say that, you know it, this is the only button it has, but do all kinds of this drama for first 30 minutes. It is with purpose that in 30 minutes, the adrenaline level is sort of equilibrated and you are in full control of yourself. And if you still feel that no, still, you know, my supervisor is in the first row and my, you know, the biggest critic is in the second row, just don't worry about that. Never look at your supervisor. That's the key. Okay. If you feel ever nervous, don't look at your supervisor and read the title of the slide. I did that. Read the title. This is the early few seconds on stage management that everyone should know if at all you ever felt nervous in giving a talk. But if you are of the other category that, no, I never felt nervous, what is there? It's not a big deal. Then you this rule does not apply to you. Okay. Now, check the pointer, check the caller mic, start very softly, read the title, and that's the only time you can read from the slide. That's my rule. Okay. Never read from the slide. If you read, I will show you what happens. Suppose you are still tensed. Oh, you first 30 seconds, I followed whatever Professor Sunoj had said, but I'm still feeling a bit nervous. What should I do? Turn to the screen and take a deep breath without anyone noticing it. This is what Boris Becker and you know, all these tennis players would do. They will do, but you can't do that facing the audience. You turn around and do that trick and come back. This is one of the tips that will be helpful. It's okay to carry a bottle of water. If you think that still I'm feeling nervous, maybe take a 5 seconds break, close the water, and then come. Dry mouth is addressed. So now within say first 1 minute, you are pretty much equilibrated. You are in control. Move on to introduction and start the show. Don't worry about being judged. It's very, very important. Why you feel nervous end of the day? Because you have fear of being judged. Keep in mind, when you are on stage, you are like this lady who is performing. And she cannot worry about, you know, what the other people are going to think about her. She is a performer. You have to be a performer on stage. Okay. So, if that is the case, do not worry about what others are going to think about you, because that is going to affect you negatively. So, you don't want any negative thoughts running through your mind when you are on stage. Okay. Do your job as best as you can. Stage belongs to you and only you. Okay. You want exclusivity, right? What is the fun in wearing a designer clothes? Everybody will be happy. Oh, next door neighbor don't have it, only I have it. You feel happy, right? So that exclusivity, the stage belongs to you for that 30 minutes. It belongs only to you. Make use of that. Okay. Now, it's an opportunity to perform. Okay. Whatever be the content, like science or arts, whatever the content of the talk is, stage belongs to you and you should feel happy, proud and privileged that, oh, it's my turn. It's not their turn. Let them speak, let them sleep. How does it matter? Of course, I know techniques how to wake people up, but that is at the advanced level. Okay. I will talk about that if time permits. Start looking at the audience. Start looking at the audience, and I think I have looked at almost everybody's face by now. I scanned different regions of the or whoever is sitting here, and these faces have already registered and I'm already familiar with the faces. You have to be looking at the audience. But in the first few minutes, what will happen for those who are first time on stage, you will see, in spite of all these light, you will see darkness. You may not be able to see because of tension, because of on stage management problem, you really don't see anyone. That's natural. It's not for you, it happens for many. Keep in mind, it's not your limitation. Okay, it's natural. Faces will become soon clear. As you spend more and more time, you will see the faces, some are smiling, some are sleeping, all these different faces you would soon be able to see, and then you will be pretty much on the national highway. You can do a great job up there in the stage. This is important. Avoid looking at the roof, sky and the stars, because what happens normally is that students are well prepared and they keep the slide, they project it on the screen, and then like they will be talking, looking at, and then somebody had shown the other day, and where are they looking at? Nobody is going to help up from the heaven. You have to be looking at, scanning different regions of the audience who are directly looking at you. Never look at the rooftop, never look at the lights, and if at all you still have a fear of looking at the audience, I will suggest you one good thing. With no intention to target anyone, there will be a few audience who will have gray hair, there will be a few among the audience who will have bald head, there will be few who will be wearing a flower. If you don't want to look at them, look at their flower. Look at the bald heads, look at the gray hair. Okay, this is another way of getting control. Okay, I could not really see them, but I can see the flower. So I will not be looking at you, but I will look at your flower, as if I am giving great show, great job on stage. So these are tiny little tricks that will help you, and these are for the beginners. After some time, you are going to be just fine on stage. Okay, these are the on stage thing, and non-verbal communication. Never read from the slide, which is actually a very, very negative way of presenting. Do not read from the slide. Okay, if you read from the slide, then what is the purpose of being a speaker? You just project the slide and go and sit there. It will put it in the auto slide change mode. Why should there be a speaker? Okay, slides are meant for the audience, not for you. How many times I turned to the slide? Because I have here. That may be your argument. The slides are only a reinforcement tool to illustrate what you want to say. Okay, you can't entirely depend on the slide. If you read from the slide, initial few minutes, what will happen? This will happen, that few people are still paying attention to. After few minutes, this will happen. It is not expected that a presenter reads from the slide, and if you are okay with the second picture, you are welcome to read from the slide. But end of the day, who is the loser? You are the loser. So don't think of reading from the slide. Look for some friendly faces in the audience. You will always have some friends looking at you. You can look at them and start speaking as if it's like a dialogue between me and my friend. Okay. These are for the early few minutes management, and then you can scan different blocks of the audience. The key here is that. Talk to me, I will forget. Show me, I will understand. Involve me, I will remember. So you have to somehow learn how to involve the audience in what you are speaking. Involve the audience into the content of what you have on the slides. Then it's going to become a successful presentation. And for a teacher like me, it's very, very important that my students are involved in what I present. Okay. So this is very important. If you involve the audience, they will remember what you talked about. But if you only talk to them, they will forget immediately. Okay, so this is going to be a successful thing, and I was because of this camera, I was asked to stay in this territory. Otherwise, I would have come there and I would have spent my time moving around like a honeybee throughout the stage. That has been the standard practice. Do not position yourself like a statue, and men would worry about how to have a good body language on stage, and you could put one hand in the pocket, or you could keep a poster, because I'm doing that way. So you could have never have this kind of as if you're going and standing in front of your principal in the college. Like, don't give a talk like this, like a statue. Be very serious, and it doesn't give a good feel for the audience. Move around, move your hands, move your feet, walk up and down, have some kind of mobility on stage, because that gives a good feel, good sense for the audience as well. Now, okay, I have everything, on stage management, everything is done, but sir, I can't speak English well. Oh, you can't speak English well? Don't worry, that's certainly not a concern, because as I said in the beginning, it's a long term process. It is not that your English in the past was bad, does not mean that you will continue to be speaking bad English throughout your life. It is an opportunity. So it is going to be a long learning process that you would decide that I will slowly and steadily improve my presentation skills, and language is part of it. And even if you speak a language, speak English in huge mother tongue accent attached to it, don't worry about that. Don't worry about whether you have mother tongue accent in your English or not. That's not an aspect that you should worry about as a beginner. And in the long run, things will improve, and it will improve for good. Use words which you are very familiar with. And I have had the wonderful opportunities to ask some question, hey, what did you say? And somebody said unprecedented. What does that mean? Unprecedented? Sir, it was there in a book. Do you know the meaning? No, sir. So do not use words which you do not know. Okay, that can be very embarrassing at times. And then one would think that somebody gave a great talk because he spoke like an American. That's a wrong notion. You are in India, speak like an Indian. And if you can afford to speak like an American, like in call centers, you may want to give a try. But that does not mean that you gave a great talk. Accent is not making a great talk. It's a wrong notion that if your pronunciation is great, you gave a great talk. That is only one aspect of it. You give a talk in your native ability to speak English with the objective that in the long run I will improve. When you give a talk first time, in first few times, don't worry about how you pronounce. You just have to convey the meaning, because these are huge negative effects that will survive in your mind and, you know, mess up your presentation. So keep in mind, it's not about how well you pronounce. It's good to pronounce better, but that is not the sole criteria of giving a good talk. Avoid mugging text, by-hearting text, etc., because that's going to be embarrassing. And then I have a statement I just want to demonstrate. I was simply going to post office, to hostel office, to find where my file was. At last I found under the table. Then I took an apple and ran to the class, but I was late. So you might have seen this kind of accent from among your friends. It's okay. That's what I want to say. It's okay depending on the regional, you know, mother tongue touch. There will be differences in the way you speak. It's okay. But in a scientific talk, that's not the point. The point is how well you can deliver the content of your slides. That you should keep in mind. Never think that these are negative things that is going to affect your performance on stage or performance in delivering the content. Modulations and demodulations, which I talked about. The local summary. Bring back into perspective what you have done till now, where you are heading to. That is local summary. That is exactly the time where you should try to modulate the monotonous rhythm otherwise you would have. Speak loud and clear. Do not murmur. Okay, many times I have seen people in periodic local summaries, no one can hear, no one can understand. Okay, so keep in mind that you cannot afford to murmur. Don't go too fast, don't go too slow. So you need a hybrid, half car and half rest. So you need some kind of hybrid that you need to know what is your natural speed. And if you pack up too many slides for a 20-minute talk, you have to go fast. That's not good. If you pack up too little slides for a 30-minute talk, you have to go terribly slow. Even that is not good. So that is where the practice and time management prior to the talk will help. Now, avoid certain words which are very, very, very common. This thing, that thing. Avoid this thing, that thing, ki, to, matlab, all in the talk. These are uncalled for words. Try to minimize those. It might come, but don't worry. But try to minimize. In the long run, you should not be using these words in the talk. Ki, matlab, all that. Okay. Now that the talk is over, what next? Questions. Oh, most nervous phase of the talk. You thought that all nervousness is over and I gave a good talk. There comes the questions and answers. Taking questions, listen to the questions carefully. Yes, yeah. So you pay attention to the question, very patiently, carefully listen. And if you know the answer, immediately respond. If you don't know the answer, take some time and think and then then respond. Many times what happens with student presentations is that they think that, oh, that faculty is like infi god hai, very you know, famous faculty, his question would be really hard, so I better don't attempt it. You know, that, like, you know, you are getting 1 out of 10. Instead of you trying and attempting to answer that question, you will get 8 out of 10. So try to take some time, try to respond positively. That is the right attitude. And if you, on some instances, if you don't know the answer, you say that, I'm sorry, can I get back to you? These are very famous international ways of dealing with questions. Can we talk it at the lunch time? Can we postpone the discussion? Can I refrain from not answering because of, you know, patenting issues and all? So there are different techniques of you know, skipping a question and telling you that, but you have to be in full control. Okay, so hierarchy is that: answer, listen carefully and answer, then take your time, think and try to answer. If you don't know the answer, you can always tell that I think I do not know the answer to that. It's a great question. And you can always say, by, if the question is good, always say, this is American way, always say that, good question. This is a typical American way, good question. I have not thought about that. Yeah, it's a good question. Maybe we'll discuss during the coffee break. So as if like, oh, you know, I don't have time right now, I'll discuss in the coffee break. So, but these are different ways of tackling the question, but never be aggressive attacking the questioner. Right? If somebody is asking, oh, he's a student, how dare you ask the question? That approach is completely, that is what I said, respect the audience, very important. It can be really backfiring big time. So respect the audience. And now, improvement, continuous process, the last module. With regards to time management, I looked at the watch and I got the note that we will wind up in just 2 minutes. Time management, you can do all the time management, but as far as I am concerned, with so many talks worldwide and in IIT, many other places, I have usually large number of slides. And I take a decision on stage after asking the chairman, chairman, how much time I have? Chairman would say, chairman, sometimes chairman may be sleeping and suddenly, oh, you have 5 minutes. Okay, good. And that 5 minutes you can use to rush through or slow down. Okay. So if you have already done too many of your slides, you can slow down in that last 5 minutes. Or you have not done not even half of it, you can decide where to stop. This is an advanced level management thing that one would learn when you are very comfortable on stage with the content. And this is a long term objective, that on stage dynamic time management. This is advanced concept, speed up, slow down, and humor. Most Western speakers will start the presentation with some sort of story. They will show a picture and talk that, oh, in this part of the world, it's all snow at this time of the year, and you have wonderful weather. That has no connection with what he is going to talk about. But this is the part of a lighthearted way of beginning a talk. In the advanced level, like, you have been talking for last 5 years and now it's time to climb up to the advanced level of giving presentations, you can build these things into your presentation. Have some humor. Pre-planned humor usually doesn't work. Okay, so have on stage way of you know, cracking jokes, or you know, pulling someone from the audience, and you could do all kinds of things if you are pretty much in control of what you are doing on stage. So what I have tried to do, so it's like a loop coming back, like in a, you know, the award movies, you would have first scene a child walking through the street and last scene child again walking through the street. So I'm like recapitalizing and coming to the point where I started. What I've tried to do as I started with some quotes, right? Many times in the presentation there were few quotes. As one person, I cannot change the world, but I can change the world of one person. So if one among you who listened to me today decided that, okay, I'm going to implement some of those recommendations made because I want to improve my presentation skills. If one of you have decided, I think I served the purpose. So that's what my simple minded approach is, that if I can change the world of one person, it's good. Now, one more thought. Yesterday is a cancelled check. Tomorrow is a promissory note. Today is the only cash that you have. Spend it wisely. So spend your time wisely, take it seriously, and try to implement these recommendations, and you are going to become a great speaker tomorrow. Okay, thank you all for listening to me.